This meeting is now being recorded.
Well, good evening. Welcome to our EDS Awareness Educational Series webinar. My name is John Furman. Before we introduce our speaker this evening, we'd like to give an overview of our free program for those attending for the first time. So we'll discuss who we are, what is our program, and upcoming events, introduce our speaker, Dr. Afrin, for this evening, and then we'll go into a Q&A session. So again, my name is John Furman. I manage the National EDS Awareness Program based in Cincinnati, Ohio. My daughter, Deanna, who's also on the call, leads the Cleveland, Ohio EDS Support Group. She was diagnosed with EDS in 2008, the same year my wife passed away with breast cancer. I was a caregiver for my wife who struggled with undiagnosed EDS for over 30 years. So we introduced our program at the 2012 EDNF conference to help EDSers form independent local support groups and spread EDS awareness in their communities. We've helped to start over 100 groups to date. Each group is given their own free website with a link from the directory and map. We receive feedback that conferences provide valuable information and social opportunities that many cannot afford physically or financially to attend in person. So we decided to bring the speakers to you through the free EDS Awareness Educational Series. We meet every first and third Tuesday, typically at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. All the programs are free. The meeting announcements and, whenever possible, recordings will be posted on our website at edsawareness.com for later replay. You can receive email announcements for future sessions by requesting the free report on our site. Tonight's presentation is sponsored by Body Support Store, where you'll find over 250 products selected by EDSers for EDSers. The store is the only funding for this program and usually covers our monthly web fees. Please visit our store and check out the helpful products that we offer. Just a general disclaimer, this presentation contains general information about EDS. Members of the EDS community voluntarily participate in this program. The information is not advice. If you're having medical problems now, please call 911 or the emergency services in your country. Always consult your doctor before making any changes to your treatment.
And the upcoming events include the Ehlers-Danlos Society Global Learning Conference held in Baltimore, Maryland, July 14 through 16. And the registration is still open. If you've listened to this webinar live, you can go ahead and visit the website at Ehlers-Danlos.com for registration to join us at that conference. And to view our upcoming webinar speakers schedule, see the webinar page on our website. For those attending live tonight, there will be an opportunity for Q&A after the presentation. Add your questions at any time by clicking the Q&A icon at the top of your screen. After typing your question, click the orange button to submit. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Afrin, and he has just published a new book called Never Bet Against Occam, Mast Cell Activation Disease, and the Modern Epidemics of Chronic Illness and Medical Complexity. If you're interested in learning more about his book, see the link on our webinar page on his website, and that's his announcement page where you'll see the image that you see here on the slide. Each book that's purchased made through our Amazon link on that page will automatically give a small amount to help our EDS awareness programs. So, again, our speaker is Dr. Afrin. He's an expert in mast cell disease, who earned his MD at MUSC in 1988, where he also pursued internal medicine residency and hematology oncology clinical and research fellowships. Dr. Afrin was on the faculty at MUSC from 1995 to 2014 and was active in undergrad and graduate medical education, educational and IT administration, and practice and research in hematology, oncology, and medical informatics. In the past 10 years, his clinical work has increasingly focused in hematology, especially in mast cell disease. He directed the MUSC's Myeloproliferative Neoplasms Clinical Trials Program, and he joined the staff at University of Minnesota in 2014. Dr. Afrin has served on national panels on oncology education and quality care and speaks widely in his areas of focus. He has an extensive record of peer-reviewed publications. He serves on the editorial boards for several journals, and is on the medical advisory board for the Mastocytosis Society. He is also a member of the American Society of Hematology and the American Society of Clinical Oncology. So with that, it is my distinct pleasure to welcome Dr. Afrin to speak for us tonight. We're going to go ahead and load his presentation slides on the screen. And Dr. Afrin, I'm going to turn over the microphone to you now. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Deanna. Very much appreciate the opportunity to address the audience. One slight correction to the introduction. My term of service on the Medical Advisory Board of the Mastocytosis Society ended late last year, so I'm, I guess, now a former member of that Medical Advisory Board. In any event, let's move ahead with this evening's presentation, mast cell activation disease, current concepts in this area. And at first glance, it might seem this is an utterly foreign area with respect to EDS, but we'll be touching later on what the potential connections might be, and they might indeed be very strong connections, but we'll have to see where the research leads. The learning objectives for tonight, try to understand the emerging concepts in this area. There's been quite a sea change in thinking about mast cell disease in the last decade. And I'll very briefly touch on the research going on at my institution, the University of Minnesota, in this area. I don't have any conflicts of interest or other disclaimers to make that I'm aware of. We'll talk briefly about what we've long known about mast cell activation disease, generally the allergic diseases, very common, of course, and the rare disease of mastocytosis. And you can see over on the right that they have slightly different clinical themes. And then we'll talk about the new kid on the block, so to speak, mast cell activation syndrome, and how to recognize it, what it looks like, and briefly about diagnosis and treatment. And then again at the end, very briefly on research. Let's start with the what we've long known about the allergic diseases. Allergy, of course, is a very common problem throughout the world. And there's a range of allergic diseases, allergy, asthma, angioedema, urticaria, and the most severe, of course, potentially fatal anaphylaxis. We all know somebody who's allergic, but I don't think many of us know just how prevalent the problem of allergy is. About 10% of the world's population is now suffering from allergies of one sort or another, and for reasons we really don't understand, the prevalence of the allergic diseases is steadily increasing. It's now clear that the allergic diseases develop as a consequence of complex interactions between genetic factors and environmental factors. And the more heavily loaded your family history is with genetic factors, the more likely it is that subsequent generations will suffer allergic disease as well. The allergic diseases tend to cause relatively little mortality or death, but so the implication of that is that most patients with allergy are going to live a life where the lifespan is equivalent to that of the general population. But there can be very significant quality of life effects, and obviously those effects become all the more important if one is indeed living a life of normal span. So this really is an important area of disease. So let's switch for a moment from the very common allergic diseases, which largely are consequences of mast cell dysfunction. And let's look at the very rare disease of mastocytosis. Back in 1869, there was the first description of a disease which we since have come to recognize as a form of mastocytosis. Urticaria pigmentosa was a peculiar form of rash that was initially described in the medical literature at that point. And about a decade later, there was the first description of the mast cell, the discovery of the mast cell, if you will. And at some later point when we have time, maybe we can talk about why it's called the mast cell, but we don't have that time right now. It took another decade before there was a linkage established between urticaria pigmentosa and mast cells, and it was understood that urticaria pigmentosa was in fact a disorder of excessive mast cell growth in the skin. And then it took another half a century, basically, before there was the first suggestion that in addition to the skin disease of mast cells called urticaria pigmentosa, that there might also be internal disease in the body linked with mast cells. That was also the decade, the 1930s, when we began identifying mast cell mediators. Actually, heparin was the very first mast cell mediator ever identified. There was a case report from California in 1949, an unfortunate death of a one-year-old child from essentially mast cell leukemia that was the first definitive case report of internal mast cell disease. More mediators were discovered as the years went on. The 1980s saw the emergence of the first classification system for the various forms of mastocytosis. And in the mid-90s, a couple of research groups in Japan identified a key mutation in the mast cells, a mutation we call D816V in a very important gene called KIT. And this mutated form of this gene was identified as a key driver for the disease of mastocytosis. And just a few years later, a major mast cell research group in Spain identified a different way of finding neoplastic or cancerous, if you will, mast cell disease using a medical diagnostic technique called flow cytometry. 2001, we had the emergence of the World Health Organization's first classification system for mastocytosis, and that coincidentally was the year that imatinib, sometimes known as Gleevec, first became available for not mastocytosis, actually, but for another disease called chronic myeloid leukemia, or CML. Imatinib was a real breakthrough for CML and actually for the whole field of hematology oncology, bringing about very impressive levels of control over that disease. And in fairly short order after that point, it was discovered that imatinib also can well control certain subpopulation of mastocytosis patients who do not have the KIT D816V mutation. Most patients with mastocytosis do have that mutation, and because of that mutation, likely are going to be resistant to imatinib, but the roughly 10% of mastocytosis patients who don't have that mutation may respond well to imatinib. And as the 2000s and the early part of the present decade went on, it became increasingly apparent that the symptoms that were being suffered by mastocytosis patients generally do not come from the excessive growth of mast cells. And this is a little different from how we see most cancers behave, where it is the excess growth of the cell of interest that causes the problems in those diseases. Whereas in mastocytosis, the problems that mastocytosis patients have far more come from the inappropriate activation of the mast cells, that is the inappropriate production and release of the mediators, the very potent chemical signals that mast cells generate and can release into the tissues to provide important communication to other cells. So the importance of mast cell activation for causing symptoms has become much better appreciated in the last 10, 15 years. So this is the spectrum of mast cell disease that we've long known. You can see the mountain there, most of it formed of allergies and anaphylaxis, less so urticarias and angioedema. And then the tip of the mountain is comprised of the various forms of mastocytosis. There's cutaneous mastocytosis, which itself can be broken down into many subtypes, and then there is systemic mastocytosis, or the internal form of mastocytosis, that's actually tenfold less common than cutaneous mastocytosis. You can see over at the right that all of these disorders of the mast cell feature inappropriate mast cell activation, whereas it's just the mastocytosis diseases that additionally feature inappropriate mast cell proliferation. This now brings us to the new concept of mast cell activation disease. Let me back up just one slide for just a moment and try to enable my cursor here. I don't know if everybody's able to see my cursor, but I'm circling the whole mountain here and trying to point out that as a result of our coming to recognize in the last decade or so that all mast cell disease, first and foremost, features inappropriate mast cell activation, we've come to rename recently this whole mountain. We used to just call it mast cell disease, and now we've taken to calling it mast cell activation disease, just to pointedly remind ourselves with each and every patient with this disease that we face that the primary problem we're dealing with in most of these patients is the inappropriate activation. Back in 1991, some very smart folks at Vanderbilt University, John Oates and Jack Roberts, were the first to publish the hypothesis that a disease that we now call mast cell activation syndrome ought to exist. They reasoned that if the primary problem in mast cell disease is, in allergies and in mastocytosis, is inappropriate mast cell activation, And if just a tiny fraction of the realm of mast cell disease additionally features inappropriate mast cell proliferation, that being mastocytosis, then there ought to be another area, another realm of mast cell disease that features many other patterns of mast cell activation with or without featuring allergy. So that was just a hypothesis that was published back in 1991, and fast forward 16 years, and we finally find published in the medical literature the first case reports of what we now call mast cell activation syndrome, where there's inappropriate activation of the mast cells that go well beyond allergy, but we don't have the inappropriate proliferation that would lead to a diagnosis of mastocytosis. Some of those initial case reports showed the KIT-D816V mutation, but others of those first few cases did not have the mutation. And also that year, an important study came out from the University of Bonn. Dr. Gerhard Molderings and his colleagues showing in a small group of MCAS patients that if you actually look beyond the what's called codon 816 in KIT and looked for mutations elsewhere in KIT, indeed, one found a great wealth of mutations, a very wide array of mutations scattered all about KIT in pretty much every patient with MCAS. Since 2008, there have been a number of other studies, mostly from various European researchers, that have gone on to look beyond the KIT gene at other regulatory genes in the mast cells, whether there are mutations present in those genes. And indeed, they have found that in most cases of systemic mastocytosis, there indeed are many other mutations in these other mast cell regulatory genes, raising the question of whether a similarly broad array of mutations might be found in MCAS patients as well. In 2010, the group in Bonn published its second study. Again, this was in a larger group, again confirming that there were many mutations scattered all about KIT in just about every patient with MCAS. And in fact, the KIT-D816V mutation itself was quite rare in MCAS, perhaps explaining why in MCAS we really don't see the stark degree of mast cell proliferation that we see in mastocytosis. And this second study also very importantly looked at a group of healthy control patients and provided the assurance that very few of the mutations being found in the patients were being found in healthy control subjects. That same year, 2010, is when the first proposal emerged from authors at Harvard and Vienna and the National Institutes of Health in the U.S. to, again, rename this whole realm of disease to mast cell activation disease, and that paper included the first proposal for diagnostic criteria for mast cell activation syndrome. An alternative proposal came out in what was published in 2011. Fair disclosure, I was privileged to be the last author on that paper. And in 2012, a revision was published of the 2010 proposal, trying to address some of the issues, some of the problems that became apparent after the 2010 proposal was published. There still are some problems in the revised 2012 proposal, and we'll talk about that briefly a little bit later. This year, actually just earlier this month, the World Health Organization has issued its latest revision of the diagnostic criteria for systemic mastocytosis. And perhaps The only thing really worth noting here that's relevant to this talk is that they actually did not make any statement regarding MCAS. I think they rightfully recognize that there remains controversy over diagnostic criteria for MCAS, and given that the WHO criteria are there's a lot of gravitas and weight behind those proposals, those criteria, and there's just not enough known yet about MCAS for the field to be in a position to be making definitive pronouncements about what ought to be the diagnostic criteria for MCAS. So we'll talk briefly a little bit later about the two principal proposals for diagnostic criteria for MCAS that are out there in the literature at this point. But this now is the revised understanding, at least in my opinion, of the full realm of mast cell activation disease. There's the same mountain that you saw before, but it's now apparent that that mountain is actually just the tip of a humongous iceberg of mast cell activation disease, and the bulk of the iceberg hidden below a waterline, if you will, of easy clinical recognizability. The bulk of the iceberg is this very large collection of a wide variety of mast cell activation syndromes of one sort or another, which we really have not yet learned how to specifically classify in any other fashion. And it's the entire iceberg that features inappropriate mast cell activation, while, again, it's just the diseases of mastocytosis at the very tip of the iceberg that additionally feature mast cell proliferation. This is just to illustrate that the mast cell is technically a blood cell. It is descended from the stem cell in the marrow, where all blood cells are made. Very interestingly, the paleogeneticists have figured out that the mast cell is one of the oldest host defense cells in all of biology. Long before we had these many other cells down here, the neutrophils, eosinophils, lymphocytes, and so on, that all perform very well at very specific defense functions. What we had to start with roughly 500 million years ago was just the mast cell. And so when you're dependent on just one cell for your defense, you can imagine this cell picks up an awful lot of tricks for keeping us alive and our evolutionary forebears, of course. Here we are in the modern era, and while we have many other types of defense cells to do such an excellent job of keeping us alive, the mast cell, although it may not be quite as important as it used to be, it certainly has not forgotten any of its old tricks, and that becomes relevant in just a moment here. A little bit more about normal mast cell biology. These cells, again, are born in the bone marrow. They leave the bone marrow very shortly after being born, and they are in the blood only very briefly, and then they quickly leave the blood and enter into one tissue or another. They are present to one degree or another in all tissues that bear blood vessels, and there are very few tissues that don't bear blood vessels, perhaps the cornea and the lens and cartilage, for example. They comprise a very small percentage of the cells in the bone marrow. When they exit the blood into the tissues, although they are present in every tissue in the body, they preferentially site themselves exactly where you would expect them to site themselves if their primary job is going to be defense. They site themselves at the environmental interfaces, the skin, the GI tract, the genitourinary tract, the respiratory tract, and surrounding vessels, blood vessels and lymphatic vessels, and also adjacent to nerves. And this is what positions them best to perform their primary function as sentinels against harmful forces on the body. They typically live about 2 to 4 years, and they're generally pretty set in the tissue that they enter after leaving the blood. They synthesize a wide array of very potent chemical substances that we generically call mediators. Some of these are stored up in granules in the mast cells so that they can be very quickly released on demand. Other mediators are only produced on demand instead of being stored up ahead of time. The mast cells can release various mediators upon various triggerings, more on the triggers in a moment. And let me skip down here to just mention that KIT, the protein called KIT that is the product of the gene called KIT, is present at very high levels on the surface of the mast cell. There are roughly about 50,000 copies of KIT on the surface of each mast cell. And KIT is the dominant mast cell regulatory element. There certainly are others, but normal functioning of KIT is critical for normal survival and activation and other functions in the mast cell. And so, I know this slide is fairly complicated. I'm not going to spend much time on it, but the point is this is a diagram, and actually a fairly simplified diagram, of KIT's role in the mast cell. And you can see up at the top here that when another signaling molecule in the body called stem cell factor docks or binds with the portion of the KIT protein that is sticking up outside of the mast cell membrane, when that binding occurs, there are changes that develop to the shape of the internal portion of the KIT protein. And those changes in the shape of the internal portion of KIT then cause activation of a multitude of other pathways, molecular cascades, if you will, inside the mast cell that lead to a wide array of functions in the mast cell, ranging from production of mediators to release of mediators into the tissues around the mast cell to yet other functions such as reproduction or growth of the mast cell, and so on and so forth. KIT, the activation of KIT leads to activation of a very wide array of downstream pathways with many, many effects. Talk a little bit more about the triggers for mast cell activation. The classic triggering pathway that most physicians are taught is driven by this type of antibody. Everyone's heard of antibodies. These are proteins made by the immune system that help us fight off various infections and assaults on the body. And one of the types of antibodies are called IgE antibodies. IgE antibodies are bound to IgE receptors on the surface of the mast cell. And when an allergen comes floating by, an allergen that is specific, specifically matches the particular type of IgE molecule, that IgE antibody that has already been bound to the surface of the mast cell, that allergen will then bind to the IgE antibody, and that binding will then cause a change in shape of the internal portion of the IgE receptor, and that results in extremely rapid activation of the mast cell with release of many pre-stored mediators and launching of the production processes for yet other mediators. So that IgE antibody-mediated process is the classic way for activating mast cells that we in medicine have long known about. But there are other ways to activate mast cells, too. There are physical stimuli that can activate mast cells. Pressure can activate them, such as you might get in instances of trauma. Exposures to heat or cold, or sometimes just temperature change, regardless of whether it's heat or cold. Ultraviolet light, other wavelengths of radiation, sometimes electrical stimuli can activate mast cells. And there are many other receptors on the surface of the mast cell by which other chemical stimuli can cause mast cell activation. Histamine, which is, of course, made by the mast cell, it's a prominent mast cell mediator and released by the mast cell, can loop back, if you will, and dock with a variety of histamine receptors on the surface of the mast cell, H1, H2, H3, H4 receptors, to further activate the mast cell. The stem cell factor, as we said before, docks with KIT. There are receptors for another type of antibody called IgG antibodies that can lead to mast cell activation. This molecule called CRF is kind of interesting. That stands for corticotropin-releasing factor, which is a hormone that is very quickly released by the central nervous system any time that we are under stress. And it's long been recognized that stress, whether physical or psychological, is a common trigger of mast cell activation, and this demonstrates that this is at least one route by which stress and the CRF that gets released when we're under stress can directly lead to mast cell activation by binding with a receptor for CRF on the surface of the mast cell, and that binding then leads to mast cell activation. There's a wide variety of other substances, too, that can activate the mast cell. Opioids, and narcotics, if you will, can activate mast cells. Another class of anxiety-relieving drugs called benzodiazepines. There are receptors for those drugs on the surface of the mast cell. So this is a class of drugs which may be able to help some patients with mast cell disease. Mast cells do have receptors for cannabinoids, and the list just goes on and on and on. The mast cell also has many different receptors that are capable of recognizing various microbes, various bacteria, fungus, viruses, etc. And so this is a manner in which mast cells participate in host defense against infection. I want to also point out that not all of these receptors necessarily drive activation of the mast cell. For example, when the benzodiazepine receptor is engaged, this actually drives inhibition of mast cell activation. I'd like to illustrate, courtesy of Dr. Theo Harrides at Tufts University, who many of you know as a longtime world-renowned researcher in mast cell disease. He was able to capture this very intriguing 3D video microscopy of a single mast cell being activated upon exposure to a molecule of a very potent mediator called substance P. And I'm going to start this video in just a moment, and after the credits roll by, you can see how the mast cell, upon exposure to substance P, just starts releasing little pockets of itself from its surface. So let me start this, and hopefully you'll be able to see it. So hopefully you can see the blebbing that's happening at the surface of the mast cell as it activates and releases its granules full of mediators. Let's move on. So the mast cell releases mediators. You saw in the previous slide, we've known about heparin, we've known about tryptase, we've known about histamine as a mediator. In fact, most physicians finish their roughly 7 to 10 years of medical training having been taught that mast cells release just a couple of mediators, tryptase and histamine. Quite often we're not even taught about heparin being released by the mast cells. But the truth of the matter is actually far more complicated than many people think about these cells. The mast cell actually releases more than a couple hundred different mediators. And this list down here, I know this is very difficult to read because it's so small, this long list of mediators, but that's actually kind of the point, that this long list of mediators actually is itself only a tiny subset of the total range of mediators that the mast cells are able to produce and release into the tissues to provide signals to other cells. And if you'd like to learn more about what these mediators and other mediators do, what the mast cell can produce in terms of mediators, I have a link down here that you can follow. This is to a cytokine or cell signaling encyclopedia called cellstalk.com. That's an absolutely stupendous piece of work from Horst Ibelgoff's, and I encourage you to visit that if you want to learn more about these mediators and consider providing support for his effort. So here we are in 2016, and the WHO has declared the following to be the criteria for diagnosing systemic mastocytosis. And I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this, just to say that there's one major criterion, and in order to diagnose mastocytosis, we have to pair up the major criterion with at least one of the minor criteria. The only major criterion is that you have to be able to find aggregates of mast cells in one tissue or another in the body. Most commonly, this is done in the bone marrow. This, by the way, is not normal. It's not normal to find mast cells tightly aggregated or clustered together. More in the normal setting, they are sort of just diffusely distributed. So you have to find these aggregates of mast cells, typically in bone marrow, and although you can pair that up with any of these minor criteria, most commonly what's done is to test the level of tryptase in the blood, a serum tryptase level, and if it's persistently over the level of 20 nanograms per milliliter, which is roughly double the upper limit of normal, then that minor criteria is found in, there are various estimates out there, from roughly 60 to 90% of all cases of mastocytosis will be found to have these substantial elevations of tryptase. And once you have the marrow that's involved with the disease and the elevated tryptase level, that makes for the diagnosis of mastocytosis. And truth to tell, these criteria do a very good job of very specifically identifying patients who have this disease, systemic mastocytosis. But these criteria also create somewhat of a problem in that it turns out there are many, many patients out there who have symptoms that are just what you'd expect in systemic mastocytosis. And remember, the symptoms are primarily coming from mast cell activation, not the excessive proliferation of the mast cell. So there are many patients out there who have the symptoms of mastocytosis resulting from inappropriate mast cell activation. But when you go looking for the mastocytosis, you go looking for the aggregated mast cells in the marrow, and you go looking for the elevated tryptase, and you go looking for the KIT codon 816 mutation, and you go looking for the special flow cytometry findings in mastocytosis, you go looking for all of that, and you can't find it. And these patients are left befuddled. Their doctors are left befuddled. They present in a wide variety of fashions. They get classified and diagnosed as having a wide array of different diseases, some of them clearly of an inflammatory nature, but not all of them necessarily being inflammatory. So you really have a problem here, and what do you do when you're faced with a patient who is quacking, sort of acting like a duck, looking like a duck, quacking like a duck, that is to say, sort of looking, acting, quacking like he or she has mastocytosis, and yet you cannot find the increased number of mast cells to make the diagnosis of mastocytosis. And now we understand this is the realm of disease called mast cell activation syndrome. So this is the situation where we need to consider a diagnosis of MCAS. So there are two sets of proposed criteria for diagnosing MCAS. There is one proposal that has labeled itself as a consensus proposal. There are a variety of problems with this proposal, and actually in the interest of time, I think I'm going to skip past the details here. Suffice to say that with this proposal, patients who meet this proposal, no question about it, they do have mast cell activation syndrome. But the way this proposal is structured, it allows for a good number of patients whose symptoms are very much those of mast cell activation to escape diagnosis by this proposal. And as a result, there's an alternative proposal out there. This one is structured a little bit differently. This has major and minor criteria, just like the WHO criteria for mastocytosis. The two major criteria in this alternative proposal for diagnosing MCAS, the first criteria is exactly the same as the major WHO criterion for diagnosing mastocytosis, but there is this additional major criterion that's been added in that you have to present with a set of symptoms that reflects inappropriate mast cell activation. And then there are the minor criteria. The first two are exactly as in the WHO diagnostic criteria for mastocytosis, and the other two here are modifications of the other two minor criteria in the WHO proposal for diagnosing mastocytosis. This criterion here has been expanded from focusing exclusively on KIT codon 816 mutations to say that now it's acceptable to find any mutation that is known to lead to a state of inappropriate activation of the mast cells. And this criterion has been expanded in the diagnostic criteria for mastocytosis. This criterion focuses exclusively on tryptase, as does the other proposal for diagnosing MCAS, where the only laboratory study that's looked at is the tryptase level. But in this proposal, we are looking for elevated levels of mediators that go beyond just tryptase. For example, histamine and its derivative and methylhistamine, prostaglandin D2 and its derivatives, the heparin level, and certain leukotriene levels, and so on and so forth. And the diagnosis here is made when you have either both major criteria met, or most commonly how we diagnose MCAS by this proposal is to take this second major criterion, the clinical presentation that is consistent with mast cell activation, combined with elevated mast cell mediator levels. And we generally want to be finding more than one. You don't want to make a life-changing diagnosis of MCAS based on a single elevated mast cell mediator level on the premise that any lab can be abnormal once. But if you find a pattern of multiple elevated mast cell mediator levels and you have symptoms that are consistent with chronic mast cell activation, and importantly, if you're unable to find any evidence of any other disease that can better account for all of what has gone on in the patient, then by this proposal, a diagnosis of MCAS is warranted. So, emerging understanding of MCAS, we are beginning to appreciate this is not the rare disease of mastocytosis. This is increasingly appearing to be an extremely prevalent disease, perhaps even to epidemic levels. And there is increasing evidence of critical mast cell involvement in a wide variety of chronic inflammatory diseases whose origins have long evaded some of our best research efforts. And we begin to ask ourselves, given that the essence of mast cell activation syndrome is chronic inappropriate, chronic multi-system illness of a generally, though not necessarily, inflammatory plus minus allergic theme. So given that broad statement, is it possible that some portions of the populations bearing each of these and many other chronic illnesses, particularly chronic inflammatory illnesses, is it possible that MCAS might be, MCAS especially with the mutations, the wide array of mutations that we think are at the root of various forms of mast cell activation syndrome, is it possible that these various forms of mast cell activation syndrome might be at the roots of some portions of the populations of patients with all of these and many other diseases? This is a question. It needs to be addressed with appropriate research. We do not know the answers yet to these questions. So mast cell activation syndrome may, according to the very intriguing research findings from the University of Bonn, may be of mutational origin, or how we say clonal, in most cases. More than 50 mutations have been found scattered across all of the various pieces of the gene and protein that we call KIT, that is the dominant mast cell regulatory element. It further turns out from the work in Bonn that most patients with MCAS have not just one mutation in KIT, but actually multiple mutations in KIT. A big part of the problem in figuring this out in the clinic, though, is that we do not yet have tests in the clinical laboratory for most of these mutations. Just in the last year or two, we're beginning to see some more advanced testing emerge, but for the vast majority of the clinical laboratories around the world, they are limited at present to looking solely for the KIT codon 816 mutation, which is very helpful in trying to diagnose mastocytosis, but probably doesn't help very much in trying to diagnose mast cell activation syndrome. That all having been said, it's important to note that the findings from Bonn showing mutations in KIT in most patients with MCAS, these findings have been published only by the University of Bonn. They have not yet been independently confirmed. That's not because others have tried and failed to find these mutations, but rather because nobody else has even tried to find these mutations. We actually, at the University of Minnesota, we are now engaged in a project to look in MCAS patients, as well as in healthy controls, at the presence of mutations in not only KIT, but also in roughly three dozen other mast cell regulatory genes. We will begin to get the results of those studies in the coming year, and we will see whether the findings from Bonn can be confirmed or not. And in the interest of time, I'm going to skip past this last item on the page here. So this is the model that's now emerging of mast cell activation disease. We know that mast cells produce and release many score mediators, and we know that just one mutation in KIT, the dominant mast cell regulatory gene, can lead to the inappropriate release of multiple mediators, which does lead to some potential for multi-system unwellness and variability from one patient to the next, depending on which mutation is present, leading to the inappropriate release of one particular set of mediators or another particular set of mediators. But it gets more complicated than that, because it's not just one mutation that's likely present in each cell. We know that, or at least we suspect, due to the work in Bonn, that there actually are multiple mutations in KIT in most mast cell patients. This would be expected to lead to even more complex patterns of inappropriate release of various mast cell mediators, creating even more potential for multi-system illness and variability of how the disease looks from one patient to the next. It's important to understand that when these mediators get released, their job under normal circumstances, as they diffuse out into the other tissues in the body, is to, as they come to contact and dock with and bind with the other types of cells in the body, the other cells in the body then adjust their functioning as needed to resist and recover from whatever the initial assault was, the initial trigger that led to the mast cell activation. And the whole system works fine as long as the mast cells are putting out the right mediators in the right amounts, right times, and right places. But the whole issue with mast cell activation disease is that the mast cells are putting out the wrong mediators, wrong amounts, wrong times, wrong places. And the other cells that are on the receiving ends of these mediators, they have no way to know that these are the wrong signals. They're just biologically programmed to react in a certain way when a certain mediator comes at it. So you get the situation of mast cell activation disease where all these other tissues are reacting in a wide variety of ways at times that they shouldn't be reacting, in places in the body where they shouldn't be reacting, in various fashions and ways and that they shouldn't be reacting, to degrees they shouldn't be reacting. And this doesn't contribute to health. This doesn't help you recover from an assault. This just makes you unwell. But the problem is even more complicated than shown here, in that we know, at least in mastocytosis, that the mutations are not limited to just KIT. And in fact, it's multiple genes in mastocytosis that are mutated in most mastocytosis patients. And this leads us to suspect, though we haven't proven it yet, that it's also multiple mast cell regulatory genes that are mutated in most mast cell activation patients. And so again, the burgeoning complexity here leads to even more potential for inappropriate mediator release, leading to increased potential for multi-system unwellness and variability of presentation. But wait, it gets even worse, because each mediator has not just one effect. If you go out to that Cells Talk cytokine encyclopedia and start looking at what each of these cytokines, what each of these signals, these mediators do, you very quickly find that each mediator has actually a unique and quite large array of effects, direct effects on other cells, indirect sort of domino chain effects, effects in the local tissues in which the mediator is released, as well as remote effects at distant tissues in the body through a variety of mechanisms. There can be acute effects. There can be chronic effects. And so you multiply all these factors together, and you see that mast cell disease has the potential for causing extreme illness, although, to be fair, there are many patients who have the disease in a very mild form as well as all the rest of the patients who are somewhere in the middle. It is this extreme variability in presentation that poses great challenges to our doctors in trying to recognize this disease and even suspect it in the first place. Of course, if your doctor doesn't even suspect that mast cell disease might be at the root of the issues, then how are you ever going to get to the point of running diagnostic testing, much less start treatment? So this is how mast cell patients look. The typical presentation, they've usually been sick for decades by the time they get diagnosed. They usually have multi-system issues. The symptoms are often, but not always, inflammatory. It is a perplexingly inconstant course. Sometimes the triggers are apparent, but often there are no apparent triggers. There's a wide variety of mediators that are output by these cells. These patients often have seen many doctors, have acquired many diagnoses. They often are labeled by their doctors, their families, their friends as psychosomatic. And very importantly, they commonly just stop reporting their symptoms, even bad symptoms. For example, some mast cell activation patients have been passing out, something we call syncope, every day for the last 5, 10, 20 years. And after a couple years of passing out every day and always waking up, they learned that it wasn't going to kill them. And they went through extensive evaluations, many doctors. They could never get an answer. And they realized that if they told another doctor about this, it would just lead to more testing that would almost certainly not find the answer. And so they learned it was kind of pointless to report those or other serious symptoms. So it's important to tell your doctors the full range of your symptoms, and it's important to the doctors to do a thorough, what we call, review of systems. To draw out of the patient the true full range of what's been going on. The constitutional issues in this disease are all over the map. Some feel hot, some feel cold, some feel both hot and cold at different times. Fatigue is the number one complaint by patients with mast cell activation disease. Profuse sweating is commonly seen. The weight and the appetite may go up or down or fluctuate both up and down. Itching is common. Very odd sensitivities and allergies are seen sometimes. And these patients not uncommonly have very long lists of allergies as well, allergies and intolerances. I'm not going to go in detail through each of these next categories. I just want to point out the theme of inflammation. Certainly there are other issues besides inflammation that develop in each of these areas of the body, but if there is any theme to this disease, it is chronic inflammation. The lymph nodes are another demonstration of the inflammatory issues in this disease. They not uncommonly will enlarge and then shrink and then enlarge and then shrink. Sometimes doctors and patients will get concerned about the possibility that an enlarged lymph node represents cancer. And certainly if that concern is present, then and if the lymph node is behaving in the manner that the doctor knows a cancerous lymph node behaves, and certainly it should be biopsied. But it also has to be understood that in mast cell disease, lymph nodes can grow, creating some worry, but then can spontaneously shrink and go away entirely. The issues in the respiratory system are all over the map, but in general are inflammatory. Many patients complain about some impairment of breathing, but I caution my fellow physicians to not ask patients the usual question of, are you short of breath, because many mast cell patients will deny that and instead will simply say, you know, there just are times when I just can't catch a deep breath. It's not that I'm short of breath. It's just I can't catch a deep breath. And sometimes these patients undergo extensive evaluations, including pulmonary function testing and x-rays and CTs and other tests with no abnormalities found. And this is very frustrating to the patients and to the pulmonologists. The cardiovascular issues are all over the map, very commonly with palpitations, rapid changes in blood pressure and pulse. These episodes of passing out are less common. The syncopal episodes more commonly are the episodes where you fairly suddenly start feeling lightheaded, weak, dizzy, like you might pass out, something we call presyncope. Occasionally, we see very aggressive atherosclerotic disease, coronary atherosclerotic disease that can lead to heart attacks. There's a wide range of malformations of blood vessels that can be seen in this disease. Swelling can be seen in this disease in the legs, the arms, the feet, the hands, sometimes the abdomen, sometimes the face. And then there are some rare syndromes that, in the interest of time, I'll skip past. The GI issues, inflammation is the theme of the day again. Patients very commonly present with alternating diarrhea and constipation. The GU, genitourinary tract issues, again, inflammation is the theme. Many patients present with, especially women, present with unending strings of so-called urinary tract infections with the curiosity that the urine cultures often are negative. And this is not an infection. This is sterile, not infectious inflammation that may be resulting from mast cell disease in the bladder and other aspects of the urinary tract. The muscles and the skeleton and the joints are involved. And it's probably worth noting at this point, given that this is for EDS awareness, that although we don't have any proof yet that mast cell disease of any sort underlies EDS of any type, there have been increasing suspicions in the last few years that mast cell activation syndrome may be a key underlying factor in at least some types of EDS, particularly the dominant type of EDS, hyperflexibility, hypermobility EDS. It's possible that, especially in view of our having been unable to find any specific mutations in any of the connective tissue proteins in EDS type 3 patients in the last few decades, any mutations that are present in the majority of such patients anyway, that maybe there really isn't any problem in the connective tissue genes and the proteins made from those genes. We now know that mast cells are, you know, that through their production of various mediators, they are integrally involved in guiding growth and development in all tissues. So it might be that chronic inappropriate signaling from inappropriate mast cell mediator release may be driving inappropriate assembly or incorrect assembly of otherwise completely normal connective tissue components. So you can start with normal proteins, but if they're not assembled properly, then it shouldn't be a surprise that the connective tissue that you get at the end of the process may not be completely healthy tissue. Very important to understand this is merely a hypothesis at present. It needs the appropriate research to prove or disprove it. You'll recall that the mast cells preferentially site themselves at the environmental interfaces, and therefore it's no surprise there are many issues in the skin and the rest of the integument, issues with hair and nails and teeth in this disease. And we should not forget the nervous system as well. Both the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system can easily be involved in this disease. I also want to point out, we're not saying here that all of these systems are necessarily symptomatic in this disease in every patient. merely pointing out the potential range of problems that can develop in a patient with mast cell activation. There are some patients who have very few problems, some patients who have a great many problems, and the majority, of course, who are somewhere in the middle. The issues with the blood-forming system, again, are all over the place. You can have too many or too few red blood cells, too many or too few white blood cells, too many or too few platelets, too much clotting or too little clotting, that is to say bleeding. The marrow, very confoundingly for this fundamentally hematologic disease, is usually normal. But when it is abnormal, the most common abnormality is a very mild disorder in the development of the various blood cells, something we call dysplasia. There are immune system effects from this disease that, as you can see here, are all over the map with hypersensitivities, increased risk for malignancies, particularly hematologic, risk for development of autoimmune diseases, risk for infection, and troubles with healing and recovering from infection. The endocrinologic and metabolic issues are all over the map, and I think in the interest of time, I'll just press forward. So this is where we find ourselves at present in summary. You know, for the last 5,000 years, doctors have been taught to diagnose based on pattern recognition. We spend 10 years or so in training, learning the, you know, hundreds if not thousands of different diseases that can afflict the human body, and we learn the patterns for each disease. We learn that symptom A plus exam finding B plus test result C should lead us to suspect diagnosis D, but this really doesn't work all that well for mast cell activation disease because of the huge range of symptoms and problems and abnormalities that can result. And so we're beginning to learn there are a couple of what we call meta patterns that might signal the presence of mast cell activation disease, either multiple chronic inflammatory illnesses, often unsatisfactorily responsive to treatment, or the situation of a definitively diagnosed illness, which still doesn't explain all of the symptoms and findings and results in the patient. For example, a patient who has, say, a definitively diagnosed lymphoma, but is passing out every day, and lymphoma is simply not going to cause that sort of a problem. So given the difficulties in diagnosing this, how are we going to get better at diagnosing this? Should we have our patients filling out questionnaires of mast cell activation symptoms in while they're sitting in our waiting rooms? There actually is one such questionnaire also produced by the group in Bonn. Should we be programming our fancy electronic medical record systems to better recognize the patterns with which these patients present and to electronically suggest to the doctor a pop-up, if you will, that maybe a diagnosis of mast cell disease should be considered? This is actually something that would be very challenging to program, but perhaps could be done. Regardless of which approach is taken, it's very clear it's going to take many, many years before most physicians are well-schooled in this area. So at present, the best diagnostic aids is simply the physician's best friend, a complete history and physical. One doesn't need a whole lot of fancy testing to figure out mast cell activation disease. You just need a little bit of the right type of specialized testing to make the diagnosis. And we need to restore our faith in Occam's razor. Many patients these days, particularly patients who are ultimately found to have mast cell disease, have come to be diagnosed with a very long list of problems. And is that patient really so uniquely unlucky as to have coincidentally developed so many different problems, all of them developing independently of one another? Or does this patient just have one diagnosis that is biologically capable of causing most or all of the findings in the case? So clearly the latter option here is more likely. Again, let's be very clear. This doesn't mean that all chronically mysteriously ill patients have mast cell disease. It simply says that patients who fit the profile that I've described may have a mast cell disorder, and it becomes reasonable for the doctor to consider that diagnostic possibility and to consider pursuing the testing for this. Speaking of testing, I know this is too small to read, but this is the key diagram from a recent paper presenting one approach to diagnosing mast cell disease, both mastocytosis and mast cell activation syndrome. Suffice to say that first one has to suspect the disease, so we doctors are going to have to learn better how to suspect it, what mast cell disease clinically looks like. And then the serum tryptase remains a good fork in the road. If it's strongly elevated, the patient may well have the rare disease of mastocytosis, and marrow biopsies and other testing of the sort may well be appropriate there. But if the tryptase is not strongly elevated, then mast cell activation syndrome becomes a greater consideration, and there is a variety of tests that can be run. These are not necessarily simple tests to be run. There are some technical challenges to doing this correctly so that you don't get false negative results. But most labs can learn fairly quickly how to handle the specimens correctly and therefore help the patient achieve diagnosis by finding elevated levels of various mast cell mediators. We don't have any formal studies of prognosis in mast cell activation syndrome yet. There is a general sense among the physicians working in this area that the prognosis of NCAS is very similar to indolent systemic mastocytosis and the allergic diseases. That is a lifespan that is equivalent to that of the general population, but that it's a symptomatic life until the disease is accurately diagnosed and effectively controlled. Most patients do eventually identify a significantly helpful treatment regimen, and there are many therapies that have been found helpful in mast cell activation patients, but it's important to note that chemotherapy drugs that kill mast cells really are unlikely to be helpful in mast cell activation syndrome. In the interest of time, I'm going to go very quickly through treatment and just focus on the categories here. The treatment for MCAS in 2016 is largely as for indolent mastocytosis, in which we really don't focus on the excessive numbers of mast cells since they generally are not causing any trouble. Rather, we focus on the activation, and we seek to identify and avoid triggers. Sometimes we're able to desensitize patients, but that's much less common. We also try to inhibit production of various mast cell mediators. We try to inhibit the release of mediators, that is, stabilize the mast cells. There's a wide array of therapies that can help with this and a number of other types of therapies that at least theoretically might be able to help with this, but a lot of research remains to be done. There are drugs that can block the release of mediators. Once the mediators have been released, these drugs can block the effects of those mediators, and the classic example here are the antihistamines. As I said before, we very rarely, if ever, are going to use chemotherapy drugs that have the capacity to kill mast cells. Hydroxyurea is a bit of an exception. It has very low potential for killing cells, but still it's not very commonly used in mast cell activation. These other drugs have much more potential for killing, and we rarely, if ever, have a need to use them in mast cell activation. There is a theoretical consideration that stem cell transplantation might be able to cure this disease, but to my knowledge, this has never been tried in this disease. And considering that stem cell transplantation itself is a very challenging procedure with a significant mortality rate, then one has to wonder why one would want to do this procedure in somebody whose lifespan is expected to be that of the normal population. we may eventually get around to trying this, testing this procedure in clinical trials in the most severely afflicted MCAS patients whose lifespans might indeed be shortened, but we'll just have to allow some time to see what happens in this area. And finally, it's very important to treat the secondary issues that arise in MCAS. And let me be sure to note that it is a big mistake to assume that any symptom that develops in a mast cell patient is necessarily due to the activation syndrome. Although mast cell disease can cause a very wide array of problems, it does not make one immune to developing other diseases. So when new problems develop, it is very important to undergo appropriate evaluation in an appropriately timely fashion for those problems. I just have a couple of slides left. Briefly, the research we're pursuing. We have completed a characterization of a large population of mast cell activation syndrome patients, and this work is now has been submitted to a journal and is undergoing review. Hopefully, it will be published later this year. We have looked at the utility of various testing various mediators in diagnosing the activation syndrome. As I mentioned before, we are trying to confirm that there are mutations in KIT and the other mast cell regulatory genes in most patients with MCAS. We are looking to identify the causative mutations in urticaria pigmentosa. Some colleagues of mine, Dr. Sheila McGinnis in pediatric dermatology and Lucy Turcotte in pediatric hematology oncology, are leading that project. And other colleagues of mine, Dr. Chella Ustin in hematology oncology and Dr. Mahmoud Khalifa, our chief of anatomic pathology, are performing this interesting study looking to see whether mast cell disease might be an important underlying factor in something called graft versus host disease, a very important ailment that afflicts stem cell transplant patients. We are we have a number of proposals in development looking to look more closely at the genetics in mast cell disease, hoping to test some drugs in mast cell disease, and beginning to explore whether mast cell disease might underlie certain other specific inflammatory diseases. If anybody out there has Durkheim's disease, I'll let you know that the University of Arizona has now opened a study of mast cell disease and Durkheim's disease, and we are collaborating with them, and hopefully the study will get off the ground very shortly. We need to improve our diagnostic techniques in this area. We need to better understand what's causing this, and we need to get much, much better at treating this. In particular, learn how to predict which of the many drugs available for this disease is most likely to help which symptoms in which patients. And, of course, we need to accomplish better education. So this is just a summary slide. No point in reiterating all that I've talked about over the last hour and 20 minutes, and I'll be happy to take questions at this point. I see that there are about 30 questions that have developed.
Yes, there are. Feel free to read through and answer those out loud.
I'm going to open up this Q&A section on my screen here, and the first question here, can there be a correlation between physical emotional stress and mast cell activation? And the answer is yes. And hopefully you'll remember from an earlier part of the presentation that there actually are direct mechanisms by which stress, both physical and psychological, can directly lead to mast cell activation. Of course, there are indirect methods of activation from stress as well. Second question here. My daughter is being treated for MCAS. She takes ketotifen, ranitidine, Accolade, Zyrtec, hydroxyzine. Even with all of these antihistamines, she still has burning, itching, flushing. Why would the antihistamines not control or minimize the symptoms? Well, again, this goes back to the essential complexity of the disease. Remember, the mast cell is putting out, has the capacity to produce and release a huge array of mediators. Histamine is just the beginning of the chaos, the molecular chaos that mast cell disease can cause in the body. So although histamines are helpful to one degree or another in some patients with mast cell disease, there certainly are some mast cell patients in whom antihistamines accomplish nothing. And instead, it's other drugs that are needed to help control their disease. In most patients with mast cell disease, it's not just antihistamines that attain control. Usually, it's a combination of antihistamines together with other drugs to help control other aspects of mediator production and release beyond just histamine. Again, this is an extraordinarily complex disease, and I urge all of you to go easy on your doctors in your expectations as to how much they understand of this at present. This has not been taught up to this point. It's not in textbooks. There are relatively few journal articles discussing this. Most physicians, 99%+ of physicians, have never even heard of this yet. It will take time for this to get out there. So just go easy on your doctors. They're doing the best they can. What are your indications for recommending a bone marrow biopsy? In my experience, I haven't had a chance to publish this yet. I actually did bone marrows in my first 100 MCAS patients and found no increased mast cells in any of them, and only found molecular level evidence of disease in two of them. So my approach is that if the tryptase is persistently over 20 nanograms per mil, a milliliter of blood, or if the pattern of presentation is much more consistent with what we expect in mastocytosis rather than MCAS, then I am quick to do not just one bone marrow, actually, but bilateral or two bone marrow biopsies, since we know that one bone marrow biopsy will probably miss mastocytosis about 1/6 of the time. Dr. Butterfield and colleagues at the Mayo Clinic published that paper more than a decade ago. What is the pattern that more reflects mastocytosis? Mastocytosis most commonly abruptly presents in middle or older age, whereas mast cell activation syndrome, patients commonly can trace symptoms reflective of mast cell activation back to at least adolescence, and not uncommonly even back to childhood, occasionally even to infancy. So those are different patterns of presentation. So between the tryptase being persistently greater than 20 and the pattern of presentation, that's what leads me to recommend or not recommend a bone marrow biopsy. Of course, the other consideration is that mast cell disease increases the risk for malignancy of all types, especially hematologic malignancy. So if there is any hint in the patient that a hematologic malignancy might be present, then absolutely a bone marrow biopsy needs to be done. But fortunately, preciously few patients who present suggestive of mast cell activation syndrome also have findings suggestive of hematologic malignancy. The next question here, in your experience, have there been patients with MCAS symptoms who could not be helped with treatment? Actually, in my experience, there hasn't been yet a patient I've treated who, in whom we have literally exhausted all available treatments. I have patients who, truth to tell, they're 2, 3, 4 years into the process, and we have yet to find significantly helpful treatment for them. But even in those patients, we have not yet exhausted all the available treatments to be tried in this disease. So I think that's the best that I can say there. Are there genes other than KIT that are associated with MCAS? We don't know that yet. That's the focus of the research that I'm pursuing at my institution. I wouldn't be surprised if others are pursuing that research at this point too. But we just don't know that yet, and we're going to have to wait for the results of all these research projects. Can mast cell degranulation or unstable mast cells cause angioedema in the GI tract, and can this lead to abdominal pain and distension, hives, et cetera? Yes. Could it be mistaken for irritable bowel syndrome instead of being a comorbid diagnosis? I think it's important to note that it's not necessarily the case. In the patients who are ultimately found to have mast cell disease after having accumulated a problem list of 57 other diagnoses, it's not necessarily the case that any of those other diagnoses is wrong. Those diagnoses may be precisely accurate diagnoses. The problem is that each of those other diagnoses only accounts for one particular subset or another of the total range of problems the patient is having. Whereas in a patient with mast cell disease, it's very common that it is the mast cell disease that can account for all of what's going on. That is, in this particular example here, this question, mast cell disease could be seen as underlying at a bare minimum, comorbid with irritable bowel syndrome and possibly underlying. So I don't know that I would say that IBS is necessarily a mistaken diagnosis. Are there currently any research studies being conducted for MCAS management? And we have a proposal on the table with one pharmaceutical company, but that is months away from opening at this point, and I really can't say anything else about that at this point. I'm not aware of any of my colleagues elsewhere pursuing any management studies in MCAS at this time. Next question, is fluctuating low hemoglobin common in MCAS? What about low B12 and low iron? Mast cell patients can have, again, mast cell disease does not render one immune to developing other problems. One can develop B12 deficiency or iron deficiency or lots and lots and lots of other problems, which may or may not be consequential to the mast cell disease. So I'm not quite sure what else to say about that. Low hemoglobin is what we call anemia. Anemia is very common, is a very common consequence of inflammation, and again, inflammation is the dominant theme of mast cell activation disease, so it shouldn't be at all surprising if one were to find some decrease in the hemoglobin in some patients with mast cell activation. Can MCAS appear suddenly, perhaps triggered by illness or hormonal changes? It can symptoms wax and wane throughout your lifetime? Yes, definitely that being more severe at different periods of your life, yes. But let me go back to the first part of this. Can it appear suddenly? Yes, but let me modify that a bit. What's more common is that the symptoms have been present at some level, perhaps not even readily appreciable, but they've been present to some degree for a long time, and then suddenly there's an escalation to a new higher level of baseline misbehavior of the dysfunctional mast cells. And that new baseline continues for months to years, and then there's another stepwise escalation up, and so on and so forth. And these escalations tend to occur relatively shortly after major stressors, whether physical or psychological. That is the natural history of this disease. In communicating with many individuals who have MCAS and EDS as well, I see a very high number of them who have eosinophilic esophagitis. I also see a large number of them have elevated eosinophils in the blood. Why would this occur with MCAS? Because some of the mediators that are produced by the mast cell actually are stimulants to the growth of eosinophils. Are petechiae on the lower legs or other body parts a common symptom, and if so, why? Actually, I do not see that problem commonly. I see it sometimes, but I wouldn't say I see it commonly. And why would it be present? Well, you might as well ask why bleeding and easy bleeding and bruising are commonly seen in mast cell activation patients. And there are at least a couple of reasons for that. We know that mast cell activation disease actually very commonly activates the part of the blood clotting system that breaks up blood clots, the so-called fibrinolytic system. And so when it's hard to hold a blood clot together and you have a tendency to break up blood clots, that's going to give you some tendency to bleed. And the other factor in mast cell activation disease that may predispose to easy bleeding and bruising is the very first mast cell mediator ever discovered back in the 1930s was heparin. Mast cells have big stores of heparin in them, and when a mast cell activates and dumps a load of heparin into the surrounding tissues, it should not be surprising if one gets, well, pretty much the same that one would get if you injected yourself with heparin. Many patients have to take heparin shots, and they know well the extensive bruising they get at the sites of those injections. A follow-up question to clarify what Dr. Afrin was saying about genetic testing. Are there tests available through geneticists? Essentially, no, and the testing from 23andMe does not identify this either. It's very important to note that the studies in Bonn looked at mutations in the mast cell regulatory genes specifically in mast cells. They did not look at any other cell population, for example, the general white blood cell population in the blood. It is possible that because the mast cells comprise such a small proportion of the total set of white blood cells, that genetic testing looking for these mutations in the general white blood cell population may miss mutations that are only presenting in the mast cells. In other words, it's possible that we may lose the signal for all the noise if you're only looking at the general white blood cell population. So again, this is yet another research question. You know, can we find in the general white blood cell population the same mutations that are being found in the mast cells? That is part of what we're addressing in our research projects at my institution. And we'll just have to see what the research shows. Is dysphagia associated with MCAS? Yes, that is a very common symptom in MCAS. Is this more so related to EDS? Well, again, that's a difficult thing to answer since we really don't know yet what the relationship is between MCAS and EDS. If MCAS is actually underlying EDS, then one can see how MCAS could cause dysphagia directly, but one could also see how MCAS could cause dysphagia through EDS as well. Another question, I'm also curious whether there's been any analysis of the role that low-dose naltrexone may play in the management of MCAS. The answer to that is simply no. I do have a number of patients who have tried it. Most have seen no benefit from it, and I know of no studies that have been done of low-dose naltrexone and mast cell disease, and I don't know of any studies that are proposed to investigate that. Next question, have any of the mast cell mediators been found to alter collagen? We do know that a number of the mast cell mediators are fibrogenic. They are capable of causing scarring and fibrosis in tissue. In a sense, that is some alteration of collagen, but whether there is a particular abnormal pattern of mast cell mediator production that can lead to the weakness in connective tissue disease that we see in EDS, we do not know that yet. We will have to. There clearly is research that can be done to answer these questions. We need to find the funding for those studies and get the answers. When you present, here's the next question. When you present multi-system symptoms to a physician, my experience has been they regard you as a hypochondriac. And again, that's not surprising because, again, most physicians have received no training in how mast cell disease can present. It is distressing to say the least, and it become rather pointless to relate these symptoms to a doctor. How can I convince any doctor to consider mast cell activation syndrome? Oh boy, isn't that a $64 million question. I don't have a great answer for that. I have seen in my own time working in this area, just the last 8 years, that indeed there are a great many doctors out there who, of course, have never heard of this and who, frankly, don't want to hear about this. But it's also been my experience that in every community, there is at least one doctor who is willing to, shall we say, think outside the box and who is intrigued by a new finding in medical science that might well explain illnesses and diseases which previously in the doctor's career had long been mysteries. And I think the challenge to the patient is you can probably size up the doctor in the first 5 or 10 minutes, whether they're going to be able to help you. And if you figure out they're not going to be able to help you, then okay. Just politely, say goodbye and move on to try to find the next doctor. And, of course, you know, take input as best you, as best you can from others who are on a similar search. And just understand that doctors have no training in this. If they were trained in this, they would have a different, understanding, a different attitude toward it. And it's just going to take time to accomplish all that training. And frankly, once you do get diagnosed, you can ask your doctor what you can do to assist in the training of other doctors. Maybe your doctor who finally has figured out a diagnosis of MCAS in you, maybe that doctor has some connection with a medical school, with medical students or residents or fellows in training, and might be able to orchestrate a session in which you could illustrate to those trainees, what this disease is like. And then they will emerge from their training having at least some awareness of this, which is a huge step forward. On the fly here, going through this webinar, I don't know that I can dream up a better answer for you right now. I've been thinking about this for 8 years and don't have a better answer right now. Is osteoporosis a common finding? Yes. And again, this is a matter of various mast cell mediators driving various inappropriate effects in various parts of the body. We think that inappropriate heparin release can contribute to the development of osteopenia and osteoporosis, and conversely, histamine release can contribute to the development of a thickening of the bones that we call osteosclerosis. I'm sure it's actually a much more complicated matter than that, but I'm just trying to give you a very high-level overview. And yes, the bottom line is mast cell disease can drive osteopenia and osteoporosis, and all patients with mast cell disease should at some point, relatively soon after diagnosis, probably undergo a baseline bone densitometry study to see whether you do have osteopenia or osteoporosis. And if so, then appropriate standard therapy for that condition is what's warranted, in addition to efforts to get the mast cell disease under better control. Next question, what is generally your indication for telling a patient they may need a bone marrow biopsy? I'm going to skip over that because we addressed that earlier. Next question, can the thyroid swell and shrink, as you mentioned that lymph nodes sometimes do? I've actually not seen that. I have seen a few patients who have developed a wealth of thyroid nodules. It's important to know, again, that mast cell disease, in addition to its that mast cells, in addition to their immune and defense functions, they also guide growth and development in all tissues. And so we see lots of inappropriate tissue growths in patients with mast cell disease. Most of the time, thankfully, they're benign. Nodules of various sorts, cysts of various sorts, blood vessel malformations of various sorts, like hemorrhoids and aneurysms. But occasionally, there are the malignancies, the malignant growths. What causes the chronic cough? This is there probably are multiple mechanisms by which mast cell disease can cause chronic cough, but the bottom line all probably gets down to inflammation in various portions of the respiratory tract that drives the cough. Is pain associated with MCAS? Actually, it is the second most common symptom in mast cell disease behind fatigue. And it is not uncommonly challenging to treat, especially since the standard pain medicines, the nonsteroidal anti-inflammatories like ibuprofen and naproxen and aspirin, and the narcotics often are triggers of mast cell activation. I try to avoid narcotics as much as possible in my patients, and some mast cell patients actually do improve with nonsteroidal anti-inflammatories, but one has to be cautious since those drugs do have the potential to trigger mast cell activation in some patients. Next question, is low blood pressure common? From one perspective, it is not uncommon to see flares of mast cell activation which produce brief drops in blood pressure. It is far less common. I will go so far as to say it is rare to see a mast cell activation patient who chronically has low blood pressure. Is fludrocortisone helpful and a safe drug to address low blood pressure long term? Fludrocortisone is a drug commonly used to address postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, or POTS, which is increasingly being suspected as possibly being a consequence of mast cell activation disease. Fludrocortisone does seem to help the POTS, at least some portion of the POTS patients, and therefore does seem to help some small portion of the mast cell population, unfortunately. And maybe it's just referral bias in the particular population that I see, but I far more commonly see patients who have not responded to fludrocortisone then I see patients who have responded to fludrocortisone. Can voice fluctuations or hoarseness be a sign of MCAS? It can. Actually saw a patient just yesterday who had hoarseness. So most commonly this is just due to inflammation in the voice box, the larynx, but occasionally it's due to inappropriate growth. This patient yesterday actually was found to have a polyp in her larynx. So again, when new problems emerge, they must undergo standard evaluation. For example, hoarseness needs to be evaluated by an ENT physician and may call for an endoscopy, a laryngoscopy, to make sure there isn't anything serious like, say, a vocal cord cancer causing that symptom. Can mast cell activation syndrome, MCAS, be all bone-related and not involve the GI tract? Yes, that's possible. Not common, but possible. Are iron injections appropriate and safe for treating anemia? Well, of course, you're only going to want to use iron to treat iron deficiency anemia. There are many types of anemia. Iron deficiency is only one type of anemia. Iron does seem to have some propensity for triggering mast cell activation, whether it's the oral form or the IV form, but there also are many mast cell patients who tolerate iron fine, and some patients with mast cell disease develop severe iron deficiency anemia. There actually are a number of different mechanisms by which that can happen, and sometimes those patients are not responsive to or are intolerant of oral iron therapy and therefore need to be tried on iron injections. This is a case-by-case assessment. And let's see, the next question here. We're getting close to the end here. When a patient has the cardiovascular symptoms you mentioned, in what ways can we differentiate between dysautonomia versus mast cell activation? This is very similar to the earlier question about, you know, how can you distinguish between mast cell activation versus EDS? Again, there's increasing suspicion that mast cell activation may underlie at least some fraction of the population with dysautonomia. And so I think right now it's very difficult to distinguish in a patient who has dysautonomia that has developed independent of mast cell activation. It might be very difficult to make that distinction and to figure out what mast cell treatment should be applied versus which dysautonomia treatment should be applied. That's a difficult question. I don't have a great answer for it. I think the key thing there is simply to take a very thorough review of systems in the patient, make sure we understand the full spectrum of what's gone awry in the patient. And if the majority of the issues fit with what we know mast cell activation can do, then it's more likely that there's just one thing going on with the patient and the mast cell activation, and perhaps that's the dominant thing that ought to be treated. Not to say that other treatments for dysautonomia would not necessarily help, but it's always best to get the most accurate diagnosis you can. Diagnosis guides therapy. Next question is hypocellular bone marrow, a common finding in the bone marrow biopsy. We see that occasionally, but it is not common. It simply means the bone marrow is not making as many cells as it should, and there can be a wide variety of reasons why that might be happening. At what point should someone who is somewhat symptomatic look into an MCAS diagnosis? For example, would MCAS be suspect if a patient has frequent GI issues due to multiple food sensitivities, numerous chemical and environmental reactions, general unwell feeling, skin itching? Well, yeah, I think if it's bothersome enough, that set of symptoms is potentially consistent with a mast cell activation syndrome. So I don't see that it's wrong to ask the question and to pursue the diagnostic testing. So I think that's the best answer I can give there. We have two questions left very quickly. This is just an add-on to the previous question. That patient we already described also has dysautonomia and bouts of tachycardia. Again, yes, in my opinion, a patient with all those sorts of illnesses, it's reasonable to consider evaluating that person for a mast cell activation syndrome. And finally, how common is dystonia, tremors, seizures, convulsions, et cetera? They are uncommon. I won't say they're rare. The dystonia is uncommon. Tremors, seizures, and convulsions, those are, I think, very uncommon to rare is the best way I would characterize those symptoms. Dystonia is a little bit more common. And that is the end of the list of questions. Deanna, John?
Excellent. Oh, we made it through all those questions. Thank you so much. We really appreciate you doing this for us and just a wealth of knowledge that you've given us tonight, Dr. Afrin. So a special thank you from all of us, all the live attendees, and those who are going to be listening to the recording later.
Well, it's my pleasure, and I just wish you all the best, and just be patient and be persistent. And good luck to all of you. Thanks for the opportunity. Good night.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention to all of you that these programs are free. We do have a store, it's called Body Support Store, that helps to fund this program and to pay for our webinar fees. So please visit the store and see those helpful products that we provide. And look forward to having you on future webinars. And thank you again, Dr. Afrin. This has been an incredible amount of good information. I'm sure that many are going to benefit from this as they play back the recordings in the future. So again, thank you, and we're going to call in the evening. So thank you all of you who have joined. Good night.
Thank you, everyone. Have a good night. Bye-bye.